Welcome, and thank you for tuning into A Sound Constitution at CHLY 101.7 FM with Cassandra, Sam, Carla, Kelly, Max, and Harris. We're fourth-year Bachelor of Science in Nursing students at Vancouver Island University in Nanaimo. We're working to demystify healthcare issues affecting our community, bringing you evidence-based information about our healthcare. This information is for education purposes only and does not replace the advice of your primary healthcare provider.
We would like to start our show by acknowledging that we are on the unceded territory of the Nanaimo people, with a broadcasting range that overlaps the Kuwatsin and the Tsleil-Waututh territories. This acknowledgement is done with gratitude to the Nanaimo people and with the intention to increase awareness about truth and reconciliation processes and efforts on Vancouver Island. Additional information and resources surrounding Nanaimo history, reconciliation, protocol, and land acknowledgement can be found on our Facebook and YouTube pages.
Hello, everyone. Thank you and welcome to A Sound Constitution at CHLY 101.7 FM. I'm your host, Kelly. And together with my co-host, Sam, we're here to talk about the digestive system. The digestive system, also known as the GI system, includes the mouth, pharynx, which is also your throat, esophagus, stomach, liver, pancreas, gallbladder, small intestine, large intestine, rectum, and anus. The principal functions of the GI system is to digest and absorb ingested nutrients and to excrete waste products of digestion. First things first. What exactly is the digestive system, and how does it function? Please enjoy this TED Talk by Emma Bryce on how your digestive system works.
Across the whole planet, humans eat on average between 1 and 2.7 kilograms of food a day. That's over 365 kilograms a year per person, and more than 28,800 kilograms over the course of a lifetime. And every last scrap makes its way through the digestive system. Comprised of 10 organs, covering 9 meters, and containing over 20 specialized cell types, this is one of the most diverse and complicated systems in the human body. Its parts continuously work in unison to fulfill a singular task: transforming the raw materials of your food into the nutrients and energy that keep you alive. Spanning the entire length of your torso, the digestive system has four main components. First, there's the gastrointestinal tract, a twisting channel that transports your food and has an internal surface area of between 30 and 40 square meters, enough to cover half a badminton court. Second, there's the pancreas, gallbladder, and liver, a trio of organs that break down food using an array of special juices. Third, the body's enzymes, hormones, nerves, and blood all work together to break down food, modulate the digestive process, and deliver its final products. Finally, there's the mesentery, a large stretch of tissue that supports and positions all your digestive organs in the abdomen, enabling them to do their jobs. The digestive process begins before food even hits your tongue. Anticipating a tasty morsel, glands in your mouth start to pump out saliva. We produce about 1.5 liters of this liquid each day. Once inside your mouth, chewing combines with the sloshing saliva to turn food into a moist lump called the bolus. Enzymes present in the saliva break down any starch. Then your food finds itself at the rim of a 25-centimeter-long tube called the esophagus, down which it must plunge to reach the stomach. Nerves in the surrounding esophageal tissue sense the bolus's presence and trigger peristalsis, a series of defined muscular contractions. That propels the food into the stomach, where it's left at the mercy of the muscular stomach walls, which pound the bolus, breaking it into chunks. Hormones secreted by cells in the lining trigger the release of acids and enzyme-rich juices from the stomach wall that start to dissolve the food and break down its proteins. These hormones also alert the pancreas, liver, and gallbladder to produce digestive juices and transfer bile, a yellowish-green liquid that digests fat, in preparation for the next stage. After 3 hours inside the stomach, the once shapely bolus is now a frothy liquid called chyme, and it's ready to move into the small intestine. The liver sends bile to the gallbladder, which secretes it into the first portion of the small intestine, called the duodenum. Here, it dissolves the fats floating in the slurry of chyme so they can be easily digested by the pancreatic and intestinal juices that have leached onto the scene. These enzyme-rich juices break the fat molecules down into fatty acids and glycerol for easier absorption into the body. The enzymes also carry out the final deconstruction of proteins into amino acids and carbohydrates into glucose. This happens in the small intestine's lower regions, the jejunum and ileum, which are coated in millions of tiny projections called villi. These create a huge surface area to maximize molecule absorption and transference into the bloodstream. The blood takes them on the final leg of their journey to feed the body's organs and tissues. But it's not over quite yet. Leftover fiber, water, and dead cells sloughed off during digestion make it into the large intestine, also known as the colon. The body drains out most of the remaining fluid through the intestinal wall. What's left is a soft mass called stool. The colon squeezes this byproduct into a pouch called the rectum, where nerves sense it expanding and tell the body when it's time to expel the waste. The byproducts of digestion exit through the anus, and the food's long journey, typically lasting between 30 and 40 hours, is finally complete.
Thank you for listening. That overview of the digestive system is by Emma Bryce. You're listening to A Sound Constitution at CHLY 101.7 FM. Welcome to the myth-busting segment of today's show, where we take some common misconceptions of the GI system and provide you with some explanations to help you maintain a healthy gut. Misconception number one, spicy foods cause ulcers. As someone who loves her sriracha, I was really glad to learn that spicy foods do not give people ulcers. Ulcers are sores on the lining of your stomach and intestine, and according to the NHS, stomach ulcers are usually caused by a bacteria named H. pylori. This bacteria can weaken the mucus lining that protects the stomach and intestine, allowing acid, which is something your stomach produces to break down food, to enter the sensitive lining beneath. Non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, NSAIDs, can also break down the stomach's lining against acid, causing damage and ulcer to form. Some people may get stomach aches from spicy foods, but they do not cause ulcers. Misconception number two, only people who drink alcohol get cirrhosis. Cirrhosis is a condition in which healthy liver cells are damaged and replaced by scar tissue, which can be caused by alcoholism. However, other factors such as hepatitis B and C can also lead to cirrhosis. Drinking too much alcohol can lead to many problems such as liver damage and pancreatitis, but it doesn't always lead to cirrhosis. Misconception number three, smoking relieves heartburn. On the contrary, smoking may actually add to heartburn because nicotine relaxes the muscle on top of your stomach, which is a sphincter. And when that muscle is relaxed, acid in your stomach may reflux back into your esophagus. And this acid reflux leads to heartburn. In the 21st century, diet has become a popular discussion topic worldwide, and there are many different diets for people to choose from. We're here to introduce some of them and talk about what these regimens entail. Keep in mind that these information are for education purposes only, and you should consult with your primary healthcare provider before deciding on a diet that is best for you. Number 1, the paleo diet. The paleo diet is based on the food that is believed to be similar to the daily diet of the cave people. The theory is that the food cavemen and cavewomen survived on is good for health because it's what the human body was meant to eat. Paleo diets are thought to be especially useful for people with diabetes, with possible benefits including weight loss, increased insulin sensitivity, and improved heart health. According to Diabetes UK, a well-formulated paleo diet typically resembles a low-carb diet that focuses on eating fresh food and removing processed food, including dairy, starch, and refined sugar. A paleo diet will usually be low in carbohydrate, high in protein, moderate or higher in fat. Paleo diets are categorized into two groups, in and out. Pre-agricultural/animal foods such as red meat and fish are in, but Neolithic-era food such as grains and dairy are out. This cuts out a lot of the bad aspects of the Western diet. Alcohol, dairy, and coffee are generally rejected on this diet, but some people may choose to modify their diet to allow these foods on occasion. It depends on how strict you wish to be. A good intake of non-starchy vegetables is recommended when following the diet. Many people who eat paleo diets are looking to return to their roots and eat more healthily. Advocates argue that humans were able to live and thrive on the diet for 40,000 years, and the modern lifestyle diseases could be prevented by returning to paleo foods. People with diabetes can attain several benefits from the paleo diet, improving their health and reducing the risk of developing the health complications in later life. So how does the paleo diet work? Because most foods and ingredients on the diet are low in carbohydrate, the need for insulin is reduced within the body. This can help to prevent insulin resistance and reduce the risk of developing health problems, such as high blood glucose levels and other heart diseases. There are no fixed macronutrient ratios on a paleo diet, but paleo diet sources tend to agree that macros should be around 20% carbs, 30% protein, and 50% fat. There is less need for a strict portion control with paleo foods than there is for a low-fat diet. However, be mindful not to overindulge on foods such as fruit, nuts, or excessive meat. Number 2, the Atkins diet. The Atkins diet is a popular low-carbohydrate eating plan developed in the 1960s by cardiologist Robert C. Atkins. The Atkins diet restricts carbohydrates while emphasizing on proteins and fats. The Atkins diet has four phases. Depending on your weight loss goals, you can start at any of the first three phases. Phase 1, induction. In this strict phase, you cut out almost all carbohydrates from your diet, eating just 20 grams of net carbs a day, mainly from vegetables. Instead of getting 45 to 65% on your daily calories from carbohydrates, as recommended by most nutrition guidelines, you get only about 10%. Foundation vegetables, such as asparagus, broccoli, celery, cucumber, green beans, and peppers, should account for 12 to 15 grams of your daily net carbs. You should eat protein, such as fish and shellfish, poultry, meat, eggs, and cheese at every meal. You don't need to restrict oil and fats, but you can't have most fruits, sugary baked goods, breads, pastas, grains, nuts, or alcohol. You should drink 8 glasses of water a day. You stay in this phase for at least 2 weeks, depending on your weight loss. Phase 2 of the Atkins diet is balancing. In this phase, you continue to eat a minimum of 12 to 15 grams of net carbs as foundation vegetables. You also continue to avoid foods with added sugar. You can slowly add back in some nutrient-rich carbs, such as more vegetables and berries, nuts, and seeds. As you continue to lose weight, you stay in this phase until you're about 10 pounds, which is 4.5 kilograms, from your goal weight. Phase 3, pre-maintenance. In this phase, you continue to gradually increase the range of foods you can eat, including fruits, starchy vegetables, and whole grains. You can add about 10 grams of carbs to your diet each week, but you must cut back if your weight loss stops. You stay in this phase until you reach your goal weight. Phase 4 of the Atkins diet is lifetime maintenance. You move into this phase when you reach your goal weight, and then you continue this way of eating for life. health benefits. According to the Atkins diet, they claim that the eating plan can prevent or improve serious health conditions such as metabolic syndrome, diabetes, high blood pressure, and cardiovascular disease. In fact, almost any diet that helps you shed excess weight can reduce or even reverse risk factors for cardiovascular disease and diabetes. And for most weight loss diets, not just low-carb diets, may improve blood cholesterol or blood sugar levels, at least temporarily. One study showed that people who followed the Atkins diet had improved triglycerides, suggesting better heart health. But there have been no major studies to show whether such benefits hold up for the long term or increase how long you live. Some health experts believe that eating a large amount of fat and protein from animal sources, as allowed on the Atkins diet, can increase your risk of heart disease or some cancers. However, it's not known what risks, if any. The Atkins diet may pose over the long term because most of the studies about it have lasted for 2 years or less. The Atkins diet acknowledges that drastically cutting carbs in the early phase of the program can result in some side effects, including headache, dizziness, weakness, fatigue, and constipation. In addition, some very low-carb diets restrict carbohydrates so much that they result in nutritional deficiencies or insufficient fiber, which can cause heart health problems such as constipation, diarrhea, and nausea. For those of you tuning in right now, you're listening to A Sound Constitution at CHLY 101.7 FM. We're here to provide education on health-related topics, and today's focus is the digestive system. Please be aware that this information are for educational purposes only and does not replace the advice of your primary healthcare provider. Number 3, the Mediterranean diet. Interest in the Mediterranean diet began in the 1950s when it was noted that heart disease was not as common in the Mediterranean countries as it was in the U.S. Since then, numerous studies have confirmed that the Mediterranean diet helps prevent heart disease and stroke. The Mediterranean diet is a way of eating that is based on the traditional cuisines of Greece, Italy, and other countries that borders the Mediterranean Sea. According to the Mayo Clinic, plant-based foods such as whole grains, vegetables, fruits, nuts, seeds, herbs, and spices are the foundation of the diet. Fish, seafood, dairy, and poultry are included in moderation. Red meat and sweets are eaten only occasionally. Olive oil is a primary source of added fat in the Mediterranean diet. Olive oil provides monounsaturated fat, which lowers total cholesterol and low-density lipoprotein, which is the bad cholesterol levels. Nuts and seeds also contain monounsaturated fat. Fatty fish, such as mackerel, herring, sardines, albacore tuna, and salmon, are rich in omega-3 fatty acids. These polyunsaturated fats help fight inflammation in the body. Omega-3 fatty acids also help decrease triglycerides, reduce blood clotting, and lower the risk of stroke and heart failure. But what about wine? Wine is often associated with the Mediterranean diet, as it can be included, but only in moderation. While alcohol may reduce the risk of heart disease, it has many other health risks as well. If you're interested in trying the Mediterranean diet, you can get started with these tips. You can build your meals around vegetables, beans, and whole grains. You can try to eat fish at least twice a week. You can use olive oil instead of butter when you're preparing meals. You can serve fresh fruit for dessert. Your gut contains millions of microorganisms inside. But how do these microorganisms actually help you with digestion and staying healthy? We have a TED Talk video from Dr. Warren Peters, a surgeon and a scientist of epidemiology, and he's here to talk about microbiome, gut bugs, and you.
When I was just a little boy, when I used the toilet, my mother taught me to wash my hands. And when I flushed and I looked at what was going down, I go, boy, you better wash your hands, you know? And that I had this little puppy, you know, this little dog. And when I saw what came out of his body, and if I stepped in it, I go, boy, I better wash my hands. And my mother taught me all about germs and how bad they were, and you should always wash your hands. And I believed her. And then I grew up and I went to medical school, and we had the microscope. And we looked at these bacteria, and we heard these stories about how they caused these epidemics and people dying all over the place. And then antibiotics came aboard, and now we could actually stamp out these epidemics of these bad germs. And then, all of a sudden, I started hearing about the good bugs. And I go, what's that? And as we begin to look at the actual genetics, this was the breakthrough that allowed us to actually understand our microbiome, particularly in our GI tract, because when I was just looking at them through a microscope, it was very limiting. You could only see just certain kinds. But now that we could actually genetically look at this, this all started about 10 years ago, and many of you are familiar with this, when they started looking at the genetics of the human. What are the genes? How many genes? What are the genes that we have? Through incredible research, it became apparent that we actually had like 26,000 genes. And I thought, wow, that's really cool. And everybody was studying the genes, and this was really wonderful, until they started studying the genes of a rice plant. The rice plant had 46,000 genes. What's that? You know, I mean, we're only 26, and there are 46? And so this was very humbling to say that the rice plant was more sophisticated than humans. So then about 5 years ago, everybody got busy, and they started to do the genome of the bacteria that resides inside of our body. Guess how many genes there are there? 100,000 genes. And so we begin to look at, what are these bugs? Who are these? What are these? So there's like 100 trillion of them. When we think of cells of our body, our biome describes 90% of all the cells. We're only 10%. So we just heard how wonderful it is to look at the astronomy and be humbled. Well, I would suggest we probably just need to look inside of us and really get humble, because the other is way beyond this. So these genes are incredible. There's about 1,000 different varieties. And then when we look at the species and sort of like that, it's incredible how diverse this whole environment, this whole biome is. And it just resides in some just humble you and me. Well, okay, let's team up with our bugs. So we're 26,000 and they're 100,000. Wow. Now we can trump the rice plant. So we better stay joined with them. So we begin to do, what actually does this biome do for us? So we first think of fermentation. Talk about a microbrewery. You know, right here in our right colon, right here, these bugs are actually fermenting, because this does a lot of good things, and they produce about the equivalent of a can of beer every day. And oh, yeah, that's true. And so, of course, we handle it quite nicely and so on. We don't get tipsy with that much. And so in this process of fermentation, some very important things are created, and they're called short-chain fatty acids. These short-chain fatty acids are critical to our immune system. So if you breed a little mouse that has no biome, this little creature is very vulnerable to infections and so on. And so in many ways, this is quite dramatic. And we wonder, where does this biome come from? Because the little human, when he's just inside the uterus, he doesn't have a lot of bugs. This is kind of coming in question here, like right now. But so far, we've always thought of it being kind of sterile inside there. But when this little child goes through the birth canal and is breastfed, that is where the microbiome starts. This is critical to the life of this child. and our C-section babies and our babies that don't get breastfed, this is very difficult. So now, in modern places and hospitals that understand this, if the little child has to be born by C-section, a vaginal swab is actually taken and placed in the child's face and mouth so that it can actually become a microbiome positive creature. Otherwise, the immune system would not develop. So this is very, very vital. So that's kind of the positive side of the fermentation. But there's a negative side to this, and this is where, remember all these cells, these thousands of different kinds of bacteria. Like most of life, it's about a balance. And when they are not balanced, we call it a dysbiosis. When that begins to happen, we find that it starts causing diseases. You know the word irritable bowel syndrome. Some of you may actually have it. You know, diarrhea, constipation, abdominal cramps, all these kind of things. You know about colitis. You've heard of people that have colitis. These kinds of things are when there is a dysbiosis. There's an imbalance between the good bugs and the bad bugs. Also, we're beginning to understand that a lot of the what is called autoimmune diseases, such as rheumatoid arthritis, multiple sclerosis, these kind of things may indeed be associated with an imbalance in our microbiome. So another thing that our bugs do is they harvest calories. Now, if you're starving to death and you're having to eat a lot of grasses and grains and things that have a lot of fiber, your body can only absorb a certain number of calories. And we can't absorb normally any calories from fiber. Fiber is just goes down to the biome. And the biome actually will harvest from the fiber, will actually harvest an extra 10 to 15% of the calories from that food we've eaten. This is how humanity has survived very, very severe circumstances. But just as there's a positive, there's also a negative. And we find when we look at this whole obese area, this people are overweight. Anybody have any deficit of calories? Lunch looked pretty good, didn't it? So we're not living in a cave anymore, and we're not starving. So this good thing can then become a bad thing, particularly if we tend towards these particular kind of bugs. They're called Firmicutes. It's a big family group, and they harvest extra calories. So when we actually look at the biome of people who are overweight or people who have diabetes, they tend to have a lot more of this Firmicutes family. Are you following me? Do you see where this is starting to lead? What if we begin to change the biome to a more balanced biome for people that were overweight? Ha, you know how this is going to go, don't you? And the studies are already being done in mice, but you know there's a lot to this. So this study came out about 2 years ago. It was a fascinating study because they took these skinny little mice and they just gave them an artificial sweetener. And sure enough, the little skinny mice became fat and became diabetic. So then the obvious scientific question is, did the artificial sweetener change the metabolism of this little mouse, or did it change the microbiome? Guess what? So they did this elegant study, if you think a fecal transplant is elegant, and they took other little skinny mice and they just did a fecal transplant from the heavy mouse that had diabetes, no artificial sweeteners, and that little thin mouse became obese and overweight and diabetic. So you begin to see how this science is beginning to progress. And a third area that I think is very critical is what we call the gut-brain axis. And when you look at animal studies, you can take, again, these little germ-free mice, and when they're born, they're kind of autistic. You know, they don't kind of hang out with their puppy brothers and sisters, and they don't eat well, and they don't do things well, and they're kind of autistic. But if you then transplant normal mouse biome into these little guys, they become normal. They just kind of hang out with each other and so on. You can see where this is going, can't you? And sure enough, it's already happening. So in Europe, there's some beautiful studies that are being done on humans. Here in America, there's some people that on the side are just giving probiotics. You know, probiotics have the microbiome in them, probiotic enemas to autistic children, and actually seeing some development. I have not seen good randomized controlled trials, but where there's a little smoke, there definitely can be some fire. Now, in the human studies, one of the things that we want to know, so we already know that the gut affects the brain. What we also want to know, does the brain affect the gut? And sure enough, when we find people that are under high stress, of course, nobody here in the audience, I'm sure, was high stress, you know, that must be someplace else. But under high stress, the biome actually changes. And what we find is that there's a breakdown. So inside the gut, there's a nice little layer of mucus. So you have all this bacteria, and here you have your gut wall. And then you have this first layer of mucus. There is no bacteria. It's a barrier. The next layer is another layer of mucus that does have bacteria in it. And under stress, those mucus layers begin to break down, and antigens from the bacteria actually penetrate into the muscle wall and therefore into our circulation. So this barrier is broken down. And there's a great deal of study that's going on now to even look at microbiome and Alzheimer's. Alzheimer's is now being called diabetes type 3. Because we know that those high insulin levels, those high sugar levels, all these things may well be contributing. So at first I thought, well, this is a little fringy. But when I begin to see that we have neuroscientists that have linked together, 30 neuroscientists in Scientific American just published an editorial saying we need to take another look at Alzheimer's disease in relationship to the biome. So let's kind of think about how we can feed this biome. What are the nutritional features that we can do to help our own biome? So first of all, we have the refined carbohydrates and the processed foods. You're probably aware that of the 600,000 foods that are manufactured in America today, 72% of them had added sugar. That did not happen by accident. Sugar is addicting. That processed food is beginning to actually alter our biome to make us less and less healthy. So obviously, I teach my patients to just, when they go to a grocery store, just shop around the periphery where they have real food. Well, at least except for the deli, maybe. But real food. Don't go into that sinister middle section unless you need toilet paper or something. But that's where the real food is there. Eat real food, because that's what our body is set up for. And then eating our vegetables, and a lot of the fermented vegetables, so your kimchi and your sauerkraut and your kefir and your yogurt, all of these natural biome foods should be part of our everyday diet. And when we think about eating some healthy fats like avocados and walnuts and these kind of things, that's very important to create a healthy biome. So, and the biome needs protein. So good quality protein can be a very important feature. Well, I like to think about the lifestyles in addition to nutrition that could help our biome. And believe it or not, our gut bugs have a circadian rhythm. They have a night and day rhythm just like we do. And there's scientists that are doing research on the circadian rhythms of bacteria. And so when you don't sleep, your bugs don't sleep. And they need sleep. So it's really important to have that kind of lifestyle where you get sleep. And believe it or not, exercise also stimulates a healthy balance of the microbiome. You begin to see a trend here, don't you? So then the one that I thought was just scary, horrible, is that our use in antibiotics in America, 70% of all the antibiotics that are used in America are used to feed the animals from which we get our eggs and milk and meat and so on. 70% of all, and why do they do that? Because you give antibiotics to an animal and it gets fat faster and it goes to market quicker. So 70%, ever wonder why we're getting more bacteria resistance? And think of all of you, you know, the first time you get a sniffle, you know, I got a cold, and oh, I got to get rid of this. Oh, I better call my doctor and ask for a Z-Pak or something, you know, quick, a Z-Pak. Every time you treat your viral infections with a antibiotic, as in bacterial, it changes your biome. So if you do need antibiotics, be sure and follow up with your probiotics, your kefir, your sauerkraut, your kimchi, whatever you prefer. You've got to repopulate your bowel if indeed you have to use antibiotics. So, gut bug cultivation. You know, we should start a primer on this. You know, there should be something like gut bugs for dummies or something like that. You know, so first of all, we have to respect them. You know, they're 90% of who we are, all of our cells, they're there. And certainly we want to take good care of them. We want to make sure that they get the proper sleep, the proper exercise. And if you have happy bugs, you're going to be a healthy person. Thank you very much.
To those of you who are just tuning in right now, you're listening to A Sound Constitution at CHLY 101.7 FM. We're fourth-year nursing students at VIU, and we thank you for joining us today. When we talk about the GI system, one of the important substances that people use is alcohol. While in moderation, alcohol is a great social facilitator that can bring people together, excessive use of alcohol can lead to several problems, including alcohol use disorder, which is a condition in which a person has a desire or physical need to consume alcohol, even though it has a negative impact on their life. According to the National Institute of Health, in 2015, 15.1 million Americans, which is 6.2% of the population, had an alcohol use problem. According to the World Health Organization, WHO, globally, 3.3 million deaths every year result from the harmful use of alcohol. A person with alcohol use disorder does not know when or how to stop drinking. They spend a lot of time thinking about alcohol, and they cannot control how much they consume, even if it is causing serious problems at home, work, or financially. Alcohol abuse can be used to talk about excessive or inappropriate consumption of alcohol, but not necessarily independence. Moderate alcohol consumption does not generally cause psychological or physical harm. However, if who enjoys social drinking increases their consumption or regularly consume more than recommended, AUD may eventually develop. So how does AUD actually form? Now, alcohol dependence can take from a few years to several decades to develop. However, for some people who are particularly vulnerable, it can happen within months. And over time, regular alcohol consumption can disrupt the balance of two neurotransmitters, which are the chemical messengers in your body, and they're GABA and glutamate. These two neurotransmitters have different functions. GABA controls one's impulsiveness, and glutamate stimulates your nervous system, so it gets people excited. Another neurotransmitter that is affected by alcohol consumption is dopamine, which plays a role in how we feel pleasure. After drinking, the level of dopamine in your brain rises and make the drinking experience more gratifying. Over the long or medium term, excessive drinking can significantly alter the level of these brain chemicals. This causes the body to crave alcohol in order to feel good and avoid feeling bad. According to the Mayo Clinic, alcohol use disorder can include periods of alcohol intoxication and symptoms of withdrawal. Alcohol intoxication results as the amount of alcohol in your bloodstream increases. The higher the blood alcohol concentration is, the more impaired you become. Alcohol intoxication causes behavior problems and mental changes. These may include inappropriate behavior, unstable moods, impaired judgment, slurred speech, impaired attention or memory, and poor coordination. You can also have these periods called blackouts, where you don't remember the events. Very high blood alcohol levels can lead to coma or even death. Alcohol withdrawal can occur when alcohol use has been heavy or prolonged and is then stopped or greatly reduced. It can occur within several hours to 4 or 5 days later. Signs and symptoms include sweating, rapid heartbeat, hand tremors, problems sleeping, nausea, and vomiting, hallucinations, restlessness and agitation, anxiety, and occasionally seizures. Symptoms can be severe enough to impair your ability to function at work or in social situations. While alcohol disorder is complicated and many may find it challenging to overcome, there are several methods to treat AUD according to the NHS and Mayo Clinic. 1. Do it yourself. Some people with alcohol problems manage to reduce their drinking or abstain without seeking professional help. Free information is available on websites and self-help books, and many find that meditation and yoga may be helpful as well. 2, counseling. This is when a qualified counselor can help the person share their problems and then devise a plan to tackle the drinking. A common method used is called cognitive behavior therapy, CBT. CBT is a talking therapy that uses a problem-solving approach to alcohol dependence. According to the NHS, the approach involves identifying unhelpful, unrealistic thoughts and beliefs that may be contributing towards alcohol dependence, such as, I can't relax with alcohol. My friends would find me boring if I'm sober. Just drink one pint can hurt. Once these thoughts and beliefs are identified, people will be encouraged to base their behavior on more realistic and helpful thoughts, such as, lots of people have a good time without alcohol, and I can be one of them. My friends like me for my personality, not for my drinking. I know I can't stop drinking once I start. CBT helps people identify triggers that causes people to drink, such as stress, social anxiety, being in high-risk environments, such as pubs, clubs, or restaurants. The CBT therapist will teach you how to avoid certain triggers and cope effectively with those that are unavoidable. 3, treating underlying problems. There may be problems within self-esteem, stress, anxiety, depression, or other aspects of mental health. It is important to treat these problems too, as they can increase the risk posed by alcohol. Common alcohol-related issues, such as hypertension, liver diseases, and possible heart diseases, will need to be treated as well. 4, residential programs. These can offer expert professional help, individual or group therapy, supporting groups, training, family involvement, active therapy, and a host of strategies for treating alcohol abuse. Being physically away from access to temptation is helpful for some people. 5, drug that provoke a severe reaction to alcohol. Enta abuse causes a severe reaction when someone drinks alcohol, including nausea, flushing, vomiting, and headaches. It is a deterrent, but it will not treat the compulsion to drink or solve the problem in the long term. 6, detoxification. Medication can help prevent withdrawal symptoms that can occur after quitting. Treatment usually lasts 4 to 7 days. Chlorodiazepoxide, a benzodiazepine medication, is frequently used for detox. 7, abstinence. Some people complete detox successfully, but they start drinking again either soon after or sometime later. Access to counseling, medical help, support groups, and family support can all help the individual avoid alcohol as time goes on. According to the NHS, in addition to alcoholic drinks, it is also important to avoid all sources of alcohol, as they could also induce the unpleasant reaction. Products that may contain alcohol include aftershave, mouthwash, some types of vinegar, perfume. You should also try to avoid substances that give alcoholic perfumes, such as paint thinners and solvents. You'll continue to experience unpleasant reactions if you come into contact with alcohol for a week after you finish taking desulfiram, so it is important to maintain your abstinence during this time. Number 8. Alcoholics Anonymous. Alcoholics Anonymous is an international fellowship of people who have faced problems with alcohol. It is non-professional, self-supporting, multiracial, apolitical, and available almost everywhere. There are no age or education requirements. Membership is open to anyone who wants to stop drinking. To those of you who are just tuning in right now, you're listening to A Sound Constitution at CHLY 101.7 FM. We're fourth-year nursing students at VIU, and we thank you for joining us today.
Hi everyone, you're here with Samantha from A Sound Constitution. Now, since Kelly mentioned earlier about some diets that have become popular, I wanted to quickly talk about something that affects many of us in our community, obesity. According to the World Health Organization, obesity has become an epidemic in our world today. There's 1 billion overweight adults, and almost 300 million of those are obese. Now, something that I was surprised learning about was that obesity is also very connected with malnutrition. Now, I'm sure you're thinking, how is that possible? When individuals consume food that is high in energy, like sugars and fats, yet are not using up those calories, that in turn can cause weight gain. But just because we consume more food or high energy food, that doesn't actually mean we're getting the right nutrients our bodies need to stay healthy. Our bodies require macronutrients, which are composed of 3 different things: proteins, carbohydrates, and fats. Humans also need micronutrients, which are vitamins and minerals. These are essential to maintain a healthy body. They do things like help our bodies create different enzymes and hormones that we need to continue to live. They help fight off illnesses and help energy levels and even our mental clarity. Now, I know many individuals within our community may not have access or the ability to access foods that help nourish our bodies. With the social determinants of health, some of us may not have the education, access, or financial ability to feed our families. So, a couple of resources within our community are the Loaves and Fishes Food Bank. There, you can sign up every 6 months with ID to receive a bi-weekly hamper. Even if you don't have ID, you won't be turned away. And in between those 2 weeks, you can go and access a Food For You hamper, Monday through Friday. Call 250-754-8347 or visit nanaimoloavesandfishes.org for locations and more information. Nanaimo also has the 710 Club. They serve our community by providing a hot, nutritious breakfast and a big lunch to go. There is no questions asked, and it's free of charge for anyone in need. They are located at 285 Prideaux Street and open from 7 a.m. to 10 a.m. Also, if you'd like to help feed our community, think about registering for Run/Walk Out Hunger in Nanaimo. It's the 6th annual event, and all the pledges that are brought forth go directly to our community. The event will be held on October 26th at Westwood Lake. Visit nanaimo710club.com for more information. Changes can be hard for people. Like for you or myself, we often worry how others may perceive those changes. One procedure that can have a significant impact on a person's life is receiving an ostomy. So let's talk about it. So first, what is an ostomy? According to the United Ostomy Associates of America, an ostomy is a surgical procedure that causes a change in the way urine or stool exits the body. Bodily waste is rerouted from its usual path because of malfunctioning parts of the urinary or digestive system. An ostomy can be temporary or permanent. Ostomy surgery is a life-saving procedure that allows bodily waste to pass through a surgically created stoma on the abdomen into a prosthetic known as a pouch or ostomy bag on the outside of the body, or an internal surgically created pouch for continent diversion surgeries. An ostomy may be necessary due to birth defects, cancer, inflammatory bowel disease, diverticulitis, incontinence, and many other medical conditions. They are also necessary in cases of severe abdominal or pelvic trauma resulting from accidents or from injuries sustained during military service. Ostomy or continent diversion surgery can occur at any age and does not lower life expectancy, but is the start of a new normal life. Next, let's talk about what a stoma is as well as the different types of ostomies. A colostomy occurs when a surgically created opening of the colon, also known as the large intestine, is made, which results in a stoma. A colostomy is created when a portion of the colon or the rectum is removed and the remaining colon is brought to the abdominal wall. It may further be defined by the portion of the colon involved and/or its permanence. A ureostomy is a general term for a surgical procedure which diverts urine away from a diseased or defective bladder. The ileal or cecal conduit procedures are the most common ureostomies. Either a section in the end of the small bowel or at the beginning of the large intestine is surgically removed and relocated as a passageway for urine to pass from the kidneys to the outside of the body through a stoma. It may include removal of the diseased bladder. Lastly, an ileostomy is a surgically created opening from the ileum, the lowest part of the small intestine. The intestine is brought through the abdominal wall to form a stoma. Ileostomies may be temporary or permanent and may involve removal of all or part of the colon. So now that you are versed on ostomies, what can be done for supporting during the transition? Well, for start, you can put into context the changes in lifestyle they have to undergo. Having an ostomy requires consistently wearing a pouch or bag on your body that collects waste. Experiencing this change can cause a great deal of emotional distress, both prior to deciding to go through with the surgery and post-op. It's important to acknowledge the potential upside of an ostomy, along with the very real and natural fears the procedure often brings acceptance of the surgery, whether it's something you or a loved one is considering, or something being already lived with. Another thing you can do is to inform yourself on misconceptions related to ostomies. Many people have fears about what an ostomy entails that aren't based in current reality. For example, you or others may think that they'll smell. However, current technology, which includes charcoal filters on many ostomy bags, make this unlikely as an outcome. Additionally, managing an ostomy bag is quite easy and not as much of a labor as what people may think. A nurse or healthcare provider can easily provide you or a loved one with the knowledge and tools to alleviate any concerns. Another concern may be they are worried they couldn't wear previous clothes they once wore, such as jeans or form-fitting clothing. Ostomies are unobtrusive and essentially invisible. People with ostomies can participate in certain activities like swimming or sports that they enjoyed before. This just requires additional considerations, such as using a stoma guard that allows additional protection during more physical activities. Lastly, also should be stressed that there are no limits on an individual who have an ostomy. Aside from dietary and medical considerations, many people with ostomies can resume the lives that they led before. It is important to recognize the weight that stigma or limiting does to a person's self-esteem. Through encouragement and support, this can allow ostomy recipients to thrive as they transition to their new normal. This can be often achieved with the benefit of support groups or organizations related to ostomies. If you or a loved one need to connect with an ostomy support group or organization in your area, visit www.ostomycanada.ca. It's a great resource to start with. Change can be tough, but it takes a village to support someone on their health journey, and we can do it.
We hope you enjoyed today's episode. We encourage you to reach out to your healthcare provider for more information. As always, check out our Facebook page for resources for today's show. If there are any topics you'd like to hear us discuss, let us know by email at asoundconstitution@gmail.com. Thank you for listening to A Sound Constitution on CHLY 101.7 FM.